speak a little bit tonight about continuing the theme of the inward life, but especially, did I speak a couple of weeks ago a little on the inward way, the inward life? And I want to continue. That was from Galatians, but I wanted to take us into particularly concentrating on the blessed gift that the Lord has given to the church, which in the majority or in so many of the churches is ignored. I don't know how you see the gift of the Spirit. So the gift of the Spirit. Probably you just take that entirely individually. You know, I have received the Spirit. Maybe like me, you know the day when you were immersed in the Spirit. I was sort of reading a certain man, a little bit of his, he never wrote a biography. He was a shoemaker in a place that I know quite well, named Görlitz in East Germany. It was a border crossing in the days when I used to go across into the Eastern Bloc, going across it from East Germany into Poland, Görlitz. I was there a couple of years ago again in 2020, right in January. And there was some meetings. It's right at the place where three countries meet, Czechoslovakia, or Czech Republic, as it now is, and Poland and Germany. They meet and those three countries touch. And, you know, his testimony is, I mean, he's remarkable, a shoemaker. And he talks about the way that God came to him in a tremendous spirit of revelation. And he describes how he saw God. Tremendous. And of course, you know, the Apostle Paul, who was taken through a three-day experience, which was a cross and a resurrection. And you know that on the third day, he was absolutely filled with the Spirit. His eyes were opened. You remember how he was brought into the street called Straight. And that's a strange prophetic element to it, where from all the things that he'd been in, he was blinded, he was put in, down into the dust, led by the hand like a little child, and brought through. And on the third day, you remember the devout man came to him, laid his hands on him, "Brother Saul," and Paul received the Spirit, and there was resurrection life that came to Paul. Some people are dramatic like that. I don't know if you've ever read Oswald Chambers' testimony about the Spirit, that he was not sure of where he stood in relationship to the Spirit and whether he had received the Spirit. And so he became deeply exercised about that and how he felt to approach the matter in the end before the Lord, that if you ask, I will give. And he did exactly that and believed what God has said, that if you ask, I will give. And he himself felt nothing, experienced nothing at the time. But as he moved on through the coming weeks, he realized that there had been, that something had taken place in his depths. Why do I say this? Lest in our individual life, we should emulate or try to get something like Paul had, something like this man I mentioned from Görlitz had. And he said, for with the eyes of my spirit, I saw God. I saw both what God is, and I saw how God is what he is. And with that came a mighty impulse to set it down. And he began to write down the way that the Lord came to him. Tremendous. He said that he was in the experience earlier on of being troubled, seeking God. And he was like in that psalm, which talks about my feet had well nigh slipped. I'd gone down and I was just looked out on the world, and everything in the world in those days seemed to be dark and dismal. And all I could see was myself as a wreck. My feet had slipped. I was absolutely down as I looked in the world. Nothing was of an answer to me. No scripture could comfort him, he says. And he says that God, when I had wholly hazarded my life upon what I was doing, my whole spirit seemed to suddenly break through the gates of hell and to be taken up into the arms of God and the heart of God. I can compare it with nothing else but the resurrection of the last day. For then, with all reverence, I say it, with the eyes of my spirit, I saw God. I saw both what God is, and I saw how God is what he is. Now, that was the experience, so dramatic. Oswald Chambers, it was not dramatic. Paul, it was dramatic. Don't seek another's experience. Unusually, we approach the things concerning the Spirit from an entirely individualistic position. You know, we read about it, and you all will have had a varied experience of entering in to life in the Spirit. Some of you may even have had that against a background that was Pentecostal, charismatic, non-charismatic. Some of you, I don't know, it varies. And that's the thing. But have you thought about the fact that God has given the Spirit to the church? Have you thought of that? The church corporate. You remember, don't you, that the Lord Jesus had at the time of the night before he was going to be crucified, the long supper time with his 12. And then one of them left early, probably before the communion. That's not absolutely clear, but probably Judas left. And to the remaining 11, the Lord Jesus spoke concerning the Spirit, and they were the representatives of the church. They were the ones, and to them he spoke about the giving of the Spirit to them, but to the church as well. What do you think about that? That on the Pentecostal day, God sent forth the Holy Spirit through his Son to the church. So, what has the church done with the Holy Spirit since? So I'm thinking of church now. What has the Roman Catholic Church done with the Spirit? Now, I know personally for sure Roman Catholics who have God's Spirit. I know Baptists that have God's Spirit. I know charismatic folks, Pentecostal folks. You know, one of the governing words in my own life all along, since the Lord called me, was this: feed my sheep. It's been a governing word in my life. Feed my sheep. Whether there be 3 or 30 or 300 or 3,000, go and feed them. And I want to say this to you before the Lord, that whether I knew I was going to be speaking to a congregation of 3,000, or whether I knew I was going to go and sit with 3 people, my preparation has been identical for every meeting. To wait before God and to look to him, to receive from him his word, to be ready in my heart, made no difference where the meeting was. And it's that that's taken me in to speak to groups of nuns and priests in days, in places, in Dublin, for instance. I was having a WhatsApp conversation with a man this week. And the first time I think I met him was in a place where priests and nuns were gathered together. And you understand, but I would ask, what is the generality of the church? Are they enjoying? So I will go to a meeting tomorrow. How many people going to that meeting go in the grace and the power and the communion of the Holy Ghost? How much do the pastors in their day-to-day life realize the presence of the Spirit? The presence of the Spirit. Do you know, God says, I will not relinquish my headship of the church. Perhaps we should say Christ says that. The Lord Jesus says, I will not relinquish my headship of the church to dominant men, opinionated men, foolish women who regard themselves as special, specially gifted. I will not do it. I will cause churches to be plucked up where needed. And you understand that The Spirit has been given to the church. The Spirit has been given by God the Father through the Son to the church. What have we done with this treasure, this wonder? And you could say to me, well, no Spirit, no church. And in one sense, I think that you were right. You're right. The church becomes just a peddler of a lot of doctrine. The church becomes something that is just a social club, an entertainment. I don't want to mention names, but I have to tell you, it grieves me to go on to YouTube, and it's grieved me to go into churches, some of which I've preached on, in, and find that there's little of the Holy Ghost there. It's a show. And I listen to some preachers, and I find there's nothing of the Holy Ghost. Some are topical, some are doctrinal. But sometimes you're conscious of the absence of the Spirit. And the Lord Jesus promised to the church the presence and the power and the person of the Holy Ghost, who would make real in the midst the Father and the Son. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful? That he's the Spirit of the Father and he's the Spirit of the Son. And Jesus, when addressing these precious 11, Judas having gone out, Jesus speaks of the Holy Spirit and what he will do. You see, what does the Holy Spirit do? I need him. You need him. The church needs the Spirit. Amen. And what a tremendous thing this is, really. When I come into John 14, because that's where I want to take you, which precedes 15, of course, you can't even be a real branch in the vine without chapter 14. Jesus doesn't talk about being a branch in the vine connected without first speaking of the Spirit. You know, I am the true vine is the way chapter 15 begins. And you, well, he doesn't even talk about you and me, does he? he doesn't talk. He talks about himself and his Father. I'm the true vine. My Father's the husbandman. And then he talks about branches after that. I don't know, where does the vine begin and the branch end? Or where does, have you thought about that? When a person, I remember in France, ministering in a place, and the household I was put to stay in for the week was in a vineyard, and I can remember looking at all these vines, and it's, you know, what's the vine, what's the branch, you know, it's all kind of vine. It's how about that? You see, when you think of the aim of spiritual life, is unity with God in your understanding, in your living, in your emotions and affections to be one with God increasingly. That's the aim. That's the bearing of the fruit. And of course, it comes from him. But you know how in the 13th chapter, how the eminence of the flesh and the natural powers of leadership are allowed to come to their full fruition in the man Peter, and how the man Peter manifests all the zeal and the power and the enthusiasm and the commitment and the loyalty and the energy of the flesh. And he says, I will go with you. I'll die with you. You know, dear Peter, the eminence of the greatness of man in his zeal, enthusiasm, this, that, and the other. And Jesus says, no, you won't. In fact, when push comes to shove, you're going to deny me. And so Peter is unafraid to allow this to be recorded. You must remember that. Because, he's unafraid. He won't hide this. He allows it to be recorded. And you know the blessed flow of the scripture. If you remove this nuisance of the chapter division between 13 and 14, just remove it out the way. And Jesus answered him, verse 38 of chapter 13, wilt thou lay down thy life for my sake? Verily, verily. Oh, you know how it comes. It's tremendous. What I love about the Lord is, of course, so much. But you notice when Jesus says to Peter in verse 36 of chapter 13, you won't follow me, you can't follow me now, but thou shalt follow me afterwards. Bless the Lord. After what? That's the question. After what? And so you shall follow me. I tend to enjoy the word shall. It seems to be a bit more weighty than will. Nowadays we use will, but I like, you know, have you ever thought about the word shall much? We don't use it so much. You shall follow me. And I've looked into the grammar this week about shalls and wills, and there's not much definitive that they say. But I love this. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. I just like that. You shall not have any other gods before me. You know, because we think in terms of commandments, don't we? The way I'm saying it is like a promise. You shall not have any other gods before me. The day is coming when you shall not have any other gods before. The day is coming when you shall not commit adultery. Hey, the day is coming when you shall not. Peter, the day is coming when you shall follow me. The day is coming. It's all right, Peter. And this is how the Lord speaks with him. Why can't I follow you? Says Peter in verse 37. I will lay down my life. He meant it, you know. He didn't know himself, did he? But he's the, as I would say, amongst that group, he seems to be the height of enthusiasm, zeal, keenness, loyalty, everything. And, you know, the cock shall not crow, or you would say, if you're reading an American Bible, the rooster shall not crow until you've denied me thrice. Let not your heart be troubled. That's nice to read, isn't it? Just flow on. Get rid of the chapter division. Jesus still talking to him. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. Oh, to take away all that sin. You're the room. You're the room. I go to prepare a place for you. The room's dirty with sin and guilt and shame. I go to prepare a place for you. These are my words. I go to a place. I go to a cross. I go to a death. I go to a suffering. I go to a place where I can pour out my soul unto death. Hallelujah. So that you can drink my blood. And my soul will be in my blood. And you can drink my soul by the blessed Holy Spirit. I'm running ahead. You know, you must eat my flesh and drink my blood. What did he do in his flesh? How did he live in his flesh? You must eat my flesh and you must drink my blood. What was his soul like? You see. Now, that's chapter 6. He's already gone through that. You know, John's gospel is the mystic gospel. It's the spiritual gospel. It's showing you what it's all about. Not enough just to believe on Jesus. You've got to eat him, got to drink him. I'm going to prepare a place for you so that all the reasons why you can't be filled with God can be removed, because you can't be filled with God if you are a filthy, dirty vessel. I've got to die to take all that away, make you clean, so that me and my Father, through the Spirit, can come and find our home in you. Find our home. Isn't that amazing that, you know, it's incredible. Many mansions. And probably you know, don't you? My Father and I will love him. Look at verse 23. I've gone through there to chapter 14, 23. If a man love me, he'll keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our room in him. Only twice in the New Testament is this word room or mansion used, both in this chapter. In my Father's house are many rooms, mansions. My old King James, I'm reading here. Mansions, same word is there in 23. We will come and make our room in him. Jesus is talking about you and me. I've been with you. I've been with you, Jesus is going to say to them in the same chapter. You know, he dwelleth with you, verse 17 at the end of the verse, but he shall be in you. And I tell you, it's lovely. It's lovely when we begin. It's so clear to me. It's been so clear to me for more than 50 years, this. What it's all about, you know, from with to in, from with to in. The Spirit couldn't come without Calvary. That's why, of course, the Blessed Lord, isn't it tremendous? You know, that time when he cries out with a loud voice, in chapter 7, you remember at the great day of the feast where the priests are busy pouring out water upon the dust in the temple. You know, Jesus in that great day, he speaks in chapter 7. It's such a famous verse, isn't it? In that last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. Isn't that wonderful? Let him come unto me and drink. You know, we go so many places, don't we, to drink. Some of us go to the Bible to drink, and that's not wrong. Let me throw this out to you, just in passing, not developing it. The Bible is not the Word of God. It is the record of the Word of God. It's about the Word of God is a person, Jesus. Jesus. And before the Word about God and his workings was written down, it was oral. It was oral, it was spoken, it was spoken, it was spoken, it was spoken. And what was spoken was written down. And then, amen, thank God we've got it written down. And that's why we must read it and read it and read it and read it and read it more. But all the time that we read it, they read and read the Word of God. It's the record of him, and he says to us, come on, come to me and drink if you're thirsty. Come to me. Do you know how to do that? Do I know how to do that? I will tell you a simple, simple secret. you've got to be like a little child and come close to his breast, to his love. Come through your own feelings of negativity about yourself, your feelings of your own, unworthiness, if you have those. You got to come through everything like that, and you got to come to his breast. And that is pretty foreign to us who tend to live up here. Pretty foreign. You know, we think, dear old, this man, you know, René Descartes, you know, I think, therefore I am. He's wrong. You know, he's wrong. You're much more than your mind and your reasonings. Much more. You know what the Apostle Paul says? What he was, I am what I am by the grace of God. That's what he says. What are you, Paul? I don't know whether you noticed that little quote from Jacobean that I said that, you know, that his testimony, he says, with the eyes of my spirit, I saw God. I saw both what God is, and I saw how God is what he is. Isn't that incredible? He saw the Trinity. He saw the three persons. He saw what God is. You know, we're all in the state of who are you? Who are you? What's your name? What's your name? It's what are you? You know, and when Jesus, come unto me and drink, I'll change what you are. What is Jesus? What is he? Come on. What is he? What are you? When you take, you know, the communion that we do in our churches, I guess you do it maybe once a month, or I don't know. When you do it and so on, but it focuses you on him. It focuses you on his outpoured life. It focuses you on his flesh, his bread. It focuses you on his blood. And I will say again to you, the blessed focus, and you must day by day eat his flesh and drink his blood. O your soul in my soul, O Christ of God, I would drink you. You know how the Old Testament says the soul is in the blood, and they weren't allowed to drink the blood. Amen. They weren't allowed to drink the blood of bulls and goats and all the rest of the stuff. Of course not. They weren't allowed, but when that precious blood was shed of that precious life, you understand the whole purpose of that sinless, wondrous, victorious, glorified life was poured out, and you, that by that means in the spirit, you should have his soul in your soul. His thinking becoming your thinking. You say, Bernard, you're going too far. No, I'm not. Have this mind in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, Philippians 2, have this mind in you. Whatsoever things are lovely, think on these things. Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Being, you see, this is that which the Spirit conveys into our lives. That's why Jesus, come unto me and drink. And then it goes on, and he that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly. Now I'm using the old version. Why not? Out of his bowels, out of the generative areas of his innermost being. It's a Hebraism. Bowels, Greek splagna. You see, it's the fountain place of being. That's the Hebrew thought, the fountain place. That's what the commentator John is writing. You know, Jesus said, out of the innermost guts of you. Do we like this language? This is much more than stuff that's heady. Up there, goodness me, I tap my head and it sounds hollow. But, you know, but it's wonderful. It's wonderful. I was talking to someone last week at a prayer meeting after the meeting had finished, and I'd prayed my heart out, and I'd never had a private conversation with this couple before, and they were sort of a little bit, I think, taken aback at the prayer, and somehow it came out that my name used to be Gargiulo, which is an Italian name, and I said, you know, my grandfather this and my father that and all that sort of thing. And then this man said, oh, that explains your passion. He said, and I said, no, it doesn't. I said, it's God that explains my passion. And, you know, but maybe the Italian bit might help a bit as well. But anyway, you know, it's wonderful. Out of your innermost parts, your bowels, shall flow rivers of living water. You know, my wife's not a preacher, though sometimes she does speak at conferences and so on. And, you know, she tells me all about the men in the supermarket she goes to, all the workers. She knows all their names. She knows how many children they got. You see, and they do things for her. They love her. She said, oh, I'm going to get one of our granddaughters has started making, peanut butter cookies. And so I said to my granddaughter, because I ate a couple of these, the first batch, and I said, look, I will give you £10 if you make me 32 peanut butter cookies, you see. So she's 10, so she's made 32, and I'm going to get them tomorrow. And, you know, and then Hazel said, I'm going to get her to make 32, and I'll give her £10 for doing that. And then Hazel said, I'll take them into the supermarket, guys, and they can have them with their coffee. And but that's Hazel's way of, out of her innermost parts, something of the living waters of God coming to the world. You understand? You see, the rivers of living water come forth as you love people, as you love them. Amen. And you know how it says here in verse 39 of chapter 7, it says, this spake he of the Spirit. He spoke of the Spirit. which they that believe on him should receive, for the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. And you say to me, well, why? But the Holy Spirit had been given. What about the Spirit coming on David and making him dance? And what about the Spirit doing this? And what about the Spirit giving Bezalel and Aholiab the abilities to fashion that tabernacle so beautiful, of gold and silver and wood and all the rest of it? And, you know, but the Spirit was given. The Spirit they gave to sort of a number of men to prophesy. You know, in those days, the Spirit, do you remember it all? The Spirit on Isaiah, the Spirit, and even John the Baptist was filled with the Spirit. But in you're saying that the Spirit was not yet given? The Spirit was mandated to do certain things in the old covenant. He was given a mandate to do this. He gave, and so the Spirit gave to this. And all the mandate was, of course, what God said. So the first day, God, the Spirit was given the mandate to make light. That was it. And he did no more and he did no less. And on the second day of creation and the third day and the fourth day, you understand. And then on the day, you know, when the Spirit was given the mandate to make sure that there was a ram caught in a thicket up on a mountain in Genesis 22, so that Abraham didn't have to kill his son. The Spirit did that. The Spirit was mandated to make sure that there was a great fish ready to swallow up that rather miserable prophet. You know, isn't it tremendous? The Spirit was working. Angels were working, according to that mandate, that commandment that had come from God upon the throne. Cyrus was moved upon of the Spirit, and he knew not God, to do certain things. It is remarkable, but the Spirit was not yet given to accomplish this marvel of pouring into believing men and women the life of God himself. Now, the life of God. You've received that life. If you've received the Spirit was given that responsibility. You take us, and I go back into John 14, because it says here that, and I just picked this out, that when the Spirit comes, it at that day, verse 20 of chapter 14 of John, you shall know that I'm in my Father, and you're in me, and I in you. You shall know. The Spirit will convey an intuitive knowledge that the Father I'm in you, I'm in my Father, you're in me. So this oneness will be conveyed to you by the Spirit. this sense of it, this reality of it. Now, all ministry comes from here. All living comes from here. These intuitive realizations that the Spirit brings. And as you look down, you find this. And verse 21, he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him. I ask the question, what does the Spirit do more than you think? More than you think. Now, you say, well, what can block the Spirit? So you can say to me, well, I received the Spirit, and I know I did. I know I did. I received him 5 years ago. I know I did. But now I'm not, where am I? Where am I? One of the things that blocks the Spirit, and if you look carefully five times in chapter 14, you will find, if a man love me, if a man love me, he that loveth me, verse 21, if a man love me, verse 23, and you go down through the chapter and you'll find verse 28, if ye loved me. And so you will discover that let your love grow cold, your love for Jesus, your simplicity for Jesus. Now test it. I was testing myself this week. I was testing myself. If there were never another meeting, if I never saw your faces again, if I was confined to a bed, if I couldn't preach ever again, if I was blinded and I couldn't read the Bible, I was testing myself. What would I be like? Would I lose my faith? Would my love for Jesus diminish? I was looking back a long way. Why did I pursue as a young man? Why did I do it? Why did I leave the music? Why did I do this? And why did I do that? And why did I make the choices that I made? And I know it was because I love him. That's it, plain and simple. And if your love for him becomes replaced by even love for the church, if your love for him becomes replaced or restricted by your love for yourself, or for success, or career. You know, if a man love me, we will come, we will make our home in you. and you shall know, and you shall be loved, and you shall be loved, and you shall be loved, and you shall know the love. These are the things he says that the Spirit will produce. These are the things the Spirit will do. The Spirit will do this in you. He will teach you. That's verse 26. He will teach you. Hallelujah. He will teach you all things. He will teach you all things. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I was driving the other day, and I saw this girl, and she'd been eating something or other, I don't know what it was, and she just threw the garbage on the sidewalk. I couldn't do that. I couldn't do it. I couldn't throw the garbage on the sidewalk. Couldn't do it. Why is that? Because he's taught me. Because all things includes all things. Includes all things. Teaches a gentleman to be a gentleman. Hallelujah. Spirits come to teach us all things. Not to leave. You see, that's what happens. If you're an untidy hound, you know, he'll teach you if you let him. He won't teach you how to be fastidious. You know, but he'll teach you how to be tidy. Hallelujah. See, the Spirit very busy, if only we'll be attentive. I think of the church now. So I switch from us as individuals to the church, you see. Oh, the Spirit's been given to the churches, and I think he's neglected. I think his presence is virtually unknown by many. They don't realize that he is a gift from the Father and the Son to lead the church, to envision the church, to freshen the vision. Glory to God, to make me a fresh man day by day and you a fresh person, you know. Isn't that wonderful to give you intuitive inward realizations that you're loved? I think he is so busy. He wants to do so much for us. And of course, I'm not now talking about tongues and prophecies and those sorts of things, because I believe that they come quite naturally when you become someone who habituates the Spirit by taking time. I will tell you this, it is not by chance that he appears as a dove. You know that? The dove. They seem to be sensitive birds. And it seems to me that my understanding of the Spirit is that he delights in your presence, your availability, your time. Before I came on to this Zoom, I was writing an email to a friend of mine, a man who feels himself to be a wretch, a man who has many, many sadnesses in his life. A man who has told me that he's knelt on the floor and yelled his heart out to God, and God has not answered him. And God has not answered him. He's yelled to God that everything he has is God's, but God has not answered him, he says. And I was waiting on the Lord this week and just thinking of this brother. And I felt the Lord sort of just prompt me, write to him. So I've written to him twice, and I said to him, and it's as though the Lord said to me, tell him a little bit about what you do. Even when you felt your lowest, what you did then. And so I wrote to him, and I said to him, when I was at my lowest, I still did the usual thing. I went and sat before God without words. I just sat there in the Lord's presence. I'm here, Lord. I'm here. And I wrote to him and I said, will you begin to do that? Forget praying. Forget words. Forget words. Just come and be there. Be there. You. Be there, even if you only manage 2 minutes, that's all right. And have 2 minutes later and later. And let the calmnesses of God begin to come to your heart. Let the presence of the Spirit, because that's what will happen. That's what will happen. It always happens. You know, it's tremendous. You can't get away from this, my brothers and sisters. The Spirit's a dove. You say, well, I want to know him as fire. All in good time. You see. But he's still your heart. Habituate his presence. Begin to listen, attentive. Have you noticed in Psalm 46, the famous psalm where you get the bit about be still and know that I am God? By the way, that be still is just this word. Cease. That's the word in Hebrew. Cease. Cease. For us westernized people, whose our minds go at a pace that is terrible, can hardly stop thinking, reasoning. I'm not talking about going into states of passivity. I'm not talking about that. But all of the mind might stop. Do you know that you don't live in the now moment? Most of us hardly know how to live this present moment and just enjoy it. Why? Because our minds are reasoning. We're looking back, or we're looking forward. We're looking back, or we're looking forward. And all the time it's like this, well, what I've got to do tomorrow. And what I'm going to say next, you know, looking back, or I remember, you know, I remember, and good memories, bad memories. Cease. Now the Spirit has come to help us in this. I'll send you another comforter. Do you remember that Jesus, their first comforter? Do you remember what he said to them in the thick of things? He said, come ye aside, come and rest a while. Come and rest. Come and rest a while. I mean, I keep saying this. I seem to be like a record stuck in a groove, you know, but this is what it's all about. Mary hath chosen the better part. She lived in the now moment, and the now moment was sitting at Jesus' feet. She knew that food was needed, that there's a whole bunch of hungry men out there, because Jesus was there with the disciples too. But she knew that she must grasp the now moment. And she sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But she was not inactive. You know, Mary was cumbered about, Martha was cumbered about. We know the story so well, you see. But have you noticed in that Psalm 46, you know, cease and know that I am God. Now, you've got to be honest about this. I've had to be honest about this in my life. I've had to be honest about it. I've had to learn to be still. But have you noticed that in that same precious psalm, you get this, there is a river that makes glad the city of God. Amen. The streams of it, the streams of it. Did you know that Jerusalem, well, where we used to live in Australia, Perth. Why did they choose Perth? Because there were two rivers there, the Swan. I forgot the name of the other one momentarily. Melbourne, the city of in Victoria, Australia, built on the Yarra. London grew up on the Thames. Even the London in Ontario has got its Thames. Cities and rivers, or lakeside places where a river flows into the lake. You understand, Jerusalem, no natural river there. No natural river there. But there is a river, the streams whereof make glad the city of God. There is a profound connection between ceasing, being still, and knowing God, and enjoying the river that makes the streams whereof make glad the city of God. Streams of joy. Streams of joy. I go back to chapter 14 of, and I must stop, but you know, most of us have heard stuff like this before, and I, what a horrible word to use, eh, for the blessed truth that God would want to gather us right into, for me to call it stuff. But that's the way that humans, you know, I'm not allowed to talk about men and women now, am I? I have to call them humans, you know, just to step up from beasts. You know, so the politically correct language just manifests the sort of idiocy of minds without God. Anyway, you're a man, you're a woman, Hallelujah. And you must remember that that blessed Jesus, that word that was with God, that word is the everlasting word. And that when he spoke words upon earth, they are eternal words, and he's not going to adapt them for the 2020s. So when he spoke about marriage, and when he spoke about this, and when he spoke about that, he's not going to adapt it. Oh, poor mankind in the 21st century. Oh, the things they're facing. Oh, dear. I will adapt my word for them. No, he will be the same, and he will call them. Call him, he says, you come to me and drink, I'll sort you out. I'll tell you, your mind, your brain, oh dear, quietness does something to your brain. Did you know that? The actual stuff that's up here. Quietness does something for you. Isn't that remarkable? There's plenty of research done. There's even some psychiatrists are realizing that with their prescribing this drug and that drug and the other drug, they're just shooting in the dark. Don't know what they're doing. Some psychiatrists are beginning to do serious brain scannings and looking at brains and realizing what's happening in this brain and damaged and how it can be healed and helped, how certain things, glory to God. Why am I saying that? Because the Blessed Spirit has been given to us. I will guide you. I will teach you. Will you rely on me? Will you habituate me? Will you let me become the one who lives in your habitation? Hallelujah. So with that, I stop. Much more to say, but I think I should stop and encourage you, each of us. We may have heard these things before, but what have I done with the Spirit? What do I do with him? What do I do with him? Have I given him room? Have I allowed him to keep my heart in love with Jesus? He shall glorify me, Jesus said. He works out of sight. He seems unknown. Do you remember an unnamed servant in the Old Testament, in a great Trinitarian chapter of the Bible? Do you remember when a father was looking for a wife for his son? Do you remember that? When Father Abraham was looking for a wife for his son Isaac. And wasn't it wonderful? That father had a servant who hadn't got a name in the chapter 24, Genesis. Hadn't got a name. The unnamed servant. And he said to the servant, you go and find a son. a wife for my son. Go and find someone of our kin." The servant went off laden with gifts. It's a lovely story. It's a lovely story. And he came to a certain place, and there was a lady who just gave to his beasts. Now that shows how my mind works. You know, I'm thinking of my wife now giving to the beasts at the supermarket, you know, the people, you know. But that Rebecca lady just gave to the servant's beasts. Yeah. And she was the one. She was the one. And he says, "Oh, thank you, God." He worships God and he says, "Oh, thank you. You've brought me to the house of my master's brethren. You've brought me there. And I know that the blessed spirits, that unnamed servant of God who's been sent to find the bride of Christ and bring us home to the Father, and will lade us with gifts on the way, and will talk to us about our husband to whom we're going to be married." You know, rejoice in the story, the unnamed servant, the Holy Spirit. You know, there was a monk, I read him years ago, his name begins with C, a French monk. He wrote a book called I Believe in the Holy Spirit. Great big thick book it is. And he called the Holy Spirit the person without a name. And I know what he meant. I know what he meant, because the Holy Spirit just wants to say, "Look at Jesus, come on everyone. Look at my Father, look at the Father, look at the Father. Look, come on." He's the spirit of this fellowship. And I don't know, I think he wants more of your company. So how am I going to give it to him? Well, take another 5 minutes and be still. You know. You say it's a waste. Well, that's the duality of your mind arguing and saying, because everything's got to produce. You know. Praise God. And Christ Jesus arose a great while before day and went out into the wilderness. I wonder if anyone on the Zoom here has been on the Sahara, out in the Sahara Desert. Hazel and I have been out there a few times, actually, when we used to go to the Sudan. We go out into the desert, and boy, what a stillness. Hallelujah. Glory to God.